Hello and good morning, and Merry Christmas to you all. Thanks. Please open up your Bibles to 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9. I'll read our text, and then we'll pray, and then we'll hear the preaching of God's word. We're just going to read the one verse this morning. Again, that's 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9. This is the word of our living God. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though being rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord of all, maker of heaven and earth, and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you for your goodness and your grace. We thank you for your goodness and grace, especially displayed in your Son, Jesus Christ, that in him all the promises of salvation have come true, that all the promises are yes and amen in Christ. So would you now help us to hear, to understand, to believe, to receive, and to keep your word? Would your Holy Spirit come, intercede? Would your Holy Spirit come to save and to sanctify your people here and everywhere, everywhere where the gospel is preached? We thank you and we love you and we pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. So just within the past 2 weeks, as I've been studying and preparing, I had at least three people unsolicited tell me why it is that they so love Christmas, that why it's their favorite holiday, even more than their own birthday. And it's because they all said the same thing. It was because it was an opportunity for them to give. Right, birthdays, it's a lot of receiving, and some of those other holidays are sometimes likewise, but this Christmas season is the opportunity to give, right? And that sense of giving really strikes at the heart of our verse here. And this verse strikes at the heart of Christmas, right? Christmas is not just a time to remember gifts and giving gifts, but it's a time to remember that which was given. Well, it's not just to remember the gifts which have been given, but it's to remember that the giver has been given, right? The king gave himself. The king gave himself when Christ was born. So last Sunday, Mark Stuckey preached on Matthew 2, and he highlighted three responses to the birth of Christ. The first response was indifference, the second response was opposition, and the third response was worship. And this morning, it is my hope that we would heighten our response of worship to Christ by meditating on three truths related to his incarnation, as described in our text here. Now, the incarnation refers to God becoming man. God, who is a spiritual being, becoming a human being while never ceasing to be truly God. And the Apostle John described the incarnation simply by writing, "The Word became flesh." All right, so when I use the term incarnation, or maybe later, if you have children, they come to you and ask, what was the incarnation? What does that mean? You can take them to John chapter 1, verse 14, and read to them, "The Word became flesh." Right, the incarnation, the birth of Christ, is the moment of his incarnation. The incarnation, then, is the doctrine which we rejoice in and sing about during Christmas. Right. And in our text, 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9, there are three truths about the incarnation. So that you might know more deeply the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. So that your response to Christ would be worship indeed. And that Christmas wouldn't be about worldly consumerism, but about Christian giving. Right? Because you've been given so much in Christ. And so the three truths you have there in your outline. The first is the riches of Christ. And the second truth is the poverty of Christ. And the third truth is the purpose of Christ. This our verse here this morning, it's so simple. There's not tough theological terminology here. It's so simple and yet so profound. Right? Simply, Jesus was rich. He became poor so that you might become rich. Now, before we go further, let me give us some historical background. Paul wrote this section of his letter to the Corinthians in order to urge them to complete the giving, which they had started the previous year. You know, Paul had been going around picking up this offering, and he'd intended to send the offering to the poor Christians in Jerusalem, but the Corinthians, they had stopped giving due to discord which arose from false teachers. And because of that discord, Paul wrote a severe letter to them dealing with the issue. And they responded, right? Paul later received a positive report about their repentance from Titus. And therefore, Paul wrote this section of the letter to encourage the Corinthians to resume their giving. In our verse this morning, specifically, Paul provides the greatest example of sacrificial giving to inspire the Corinthians to give. Look back at that verse 9. It says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ." Now, we need to stop right there at those words. We need to just sit back in awe and wonder. You know, sometimes we can read the Bible, our Bibles, too fast. And we need to let these words have their effect upon us. As I read this, I imagine what Paul could have written. He could have written, "For you know the power of God, that he made the heavens and the earth, and he owns everything." Right? What do you have that doesn't belong first and foremost to God? Right? You think your money belongs to you? What's in your wallet or your bank account? Your job, your house, even your children? Psalm 24:1 says, "The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and those who dwell therein." Or Paul could have written, "For you know the sovereignty of God, that he is master and Lord of all. He is in control. He governs your life. He makes the rules and sets the standards. Therefore, you should give because God has desired that you should give for the sake of the poor." He compels you to give. Or he could have written, "For you know the justice of God, that he will repay good for good and evil for evil. Right? That what you withhold from your brothers, God will withhold from you." God knows everything. He knows what's in your wallet. He knows what's in your bank account. He's not going to let anyone off the hook. But Paul doesn't do that. Instead, and amazingly, Paul writes, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ." May our ears never grow dull of hearing those sweet sounds of God's amazing grace. Right? May our eyes never cease to delight in seeing the King in his beauty. This is why we celebrate Christmas. For those who think that we can perhaps overdo Christmas, I would contend against that. I think we ought to let our halls be decked and to adorn our Christmas trees and to light up our houses. Right? Let your homes be so filled with Christmas cheer that people must ask, "Why all the pomp?" And then you can respond, "Because we've come to know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ." We celebrate the day that the Savior of the world was born unto us. And as we consider the grace of Jesus Christ, let us then turn to our first major point, the riches of Christ. Again, our text reads, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ." And here's our first point, that though being rich, this phrase, being rich, it lets us know that before Christ became poor by his human birth, he always existed eternally as true God. Here, the riches of Christ are not referred to his earthly existence, but to the divine glory that he had with the Father before the creation of the world. The crucial question then is, how rich was the pre-incarnate Christ? How rich was the pre-incarnate Christ? And this morning, I'm going to answer this in three ways for us. How rich was the pre-incarnate Christ? First, we'll answer this question by considering his divine person. His divine person. That is to say, Christ is God. All of the divine attributes that we might ascribe to the Father or the Holy Spirit may also be rightly used to describe Christ. In John 17, verse 5, Jesus Christ said that before the world existed, he had the same glory which belonged to the Father. As we consider his divine person, we ought to remember that Christ himself is the creator. Genesis 1:1 says, in the beginning, God created. And then John 1 says, in the beginning was the Word. Right, John 1:1 is intended to parallel Genesis 1:1, specifically with Christ in view, to show that he is indeed the creator. He's the creator and he is eternal. Christ told the Jews, before Abraham was, I am. Christ is God. He's not a created being. He existed eternally without beginning or end. Christ is true deity, co-eternal and co-equal with the Father and the Holy Spirit. Whatever we could say about the Father and whatever we could say about the Holy Spirit, we could say of Christ. He is supreme. He is sovereign. He's infinite, immortal, immutable, impassible, all-powerful, all-knowing, all-present, all-wise, all-good, all-just, all-loving, all-perfect. We could consider the names or the titles of Christ, the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, Emmanuel, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace, I Am, Lord of All, True God, Holy One, Son of God, Son of Man. That these divine titles all belong to the immeasurably rich Christ. That is his divine person. And secondly, we can look at his sovereign rule. Right, how rich was the pre-incarnate Christ? We can consider his sovereign rule. That Christ indeed made all things. Therefore, he has the authority and the power to govern all things. John chapter 1, verse 3 says, all things came into being through him, and apart from him, nothing came into being that has come into being. John 1:10 makes it even more explicit. The world was made through him, speaking of Christ. Colossians 1:16 says, for in him, that's Christ, all things were created, both in the heavens and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. As creator and as sovereign, it is Christ's divine power and prerogative which sustains and governs all creation. Colossians 1:17 says, in him all things hold together. Hebrews 1, verse 3 says, Jesus Christ upholds all things by the power of his word. Since he made and upholds all things belong to him. He is rich in his sovereign rule. And then thirdly, he is rich in his Trinitarian relationship. He is rich in his Trinitarian relationship. All that Jesus Christ has ever known is perfect, unceasing communion with the God, within the Godhead. All that Christ has ever known is perfect, unceasing communion within the Godhead. This means that Christ has never felt the yearning of missing his Father, because there has never been even the slightest break in their relationship. As I think about the Christmas season, there's something about Christmas especially that makes me acutely aware of the feeling of being distant from certain loved ones. I don't know if you can relate with that, but I found that to be true for myself, and as you maybe think about that, that feeling of being distant from loved ones, perhaps you can think of a wayward son. Perhaps your marriage isn't what it ought to be. Perhaps it's a strange relationship. Christmas is approaching and everything's supposed to be happy and well, but you haven't really been talking. Right? There's a lingering issue perhaps that is yet to be resolved. Perhaps there has this year been someone who has passed away, and this will be the first Christmas without that loved one. Right? All of that is foreign in the Godhead. The Son has never felt distant from God the Father or the Holy Spirit for even an instant. He's never experienced any sadness or disappointment owing to his Father or the Spirit. There's never been any disunity or disconnect. There's never been any confusion or lack of communication. Jesus Christ has never wondered about his Father's plans. Jesus Christ, he's never been in suspense about the workings of the Holy Spirit. In the Trinitarian relationship, there's only ever been perfect harmony, pure love, full joy and pleasures forevermore. I want you to hold that thought just in your mind, because we're trying to delve into the riches of Christ, and eventually we're going to get into the poverty of Christ. So you have to keep that thought in mind of the perfection of that relationship with the Father, because it will be broken. As we think about the riches of Christ, I then ask this question: why is it important to meditate on the riches of Christ during Christmas? Why is it important to meditate, to reflect, to ponder, and think on the riches of Christ during Christmas? It's because you need to know the spiritual heights from which the King of Heaven descended in his birth. In some ways, meditating on the riches of Jesus, of Christ, is like climbing a high mountain. You know, anyone who's climbed to the top of a mountain knows what it's like to look out and marvel at the majesty of the expanse before them. Likewise, you were made to marvel at the majesty of the expanse of God. Just last weekend, a few of us went up to the coast of Northern California, and we stopped along the way back. We stood at the edge of these high cliffs overlooking the Pacific Ocean. Right, and it's there on the elevated platform as we looked out upon the vast creation. Not just me thinking about how small I am, but how great our Creator is, how big he is, how vast, and how rich Christ is. This is all his. As we come to study and to meditate on the scriptures, I would remind you that the riches of Christ, the incarnation, is not just for evangelical elites. The incarnation is not just for theologians and scholars to look into. No, you were made to know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and in knowing it, worship. So whether you're 15 or 50, labor to ascend the theological hills of God. Right? I can describe to you what it's like to stand at the edge of the Grand Canyon or on top of a high mountain. I could describe to you the hundreds of feet, but until you've looked over the edge yourself, that you never really know. And so you must ascend the hill. Ascend the hill called the riches of Christ, so that you might peer into the valley of Christ's poverty and know just how far down it was that he condescended. And in knowing that, you might know more deeply the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. And now we transition from pondering the heights of Christ's riches to plumbing the depths of his poverty. Our second major point now, the poverty of Christ. Look back in your Bible. Verse 9, after he says that though being rich, yet for your sake, he became poor. For your sake, he became poor. In becoming poor, this does not mean that Jesus stopped being God or that he relinquished any of his divine attributes. Since then, Jesus would be less than truly God. And Colossians 2:9 clearly tells us that in Christ, all the fullness of deity dwells bodily. And all the fullness of deity dwells bodily. Rather, the phrase he became poor means that Jesus Christ experienced a poverty, right? The poverty. He experienced the poverty of taking the form of a slave. He experienced the poverty of being made in the likeness of men. Jesus experienced the poverty of humbling himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. In the incarnation, God was made low. We've been singing about this all morning. He never stopped being God in the slightest, but his glory was veiled in humanity. In his coming in the flesh, he was made poor circumstantially and spiritually. So not similar to the first major question, we must now ask the question, how poor was the incarnate Christ? So the first question was, how rich is the pre-incarnate Christ? And now we ask, how poor was the incarnate Christ? We can first consider the poverty of Christ in his humble birth. Let me read again to you Luke chapter 2, verse 7. And listen closely. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and she wrapped him in cloths and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the guest room. Right? As I read that, don't miss the significance of the explanation. They laid him in a manger. Jesus Christ was born in a feeding trough, not because his parents couldn't afford a room, but because there wasn't any more room. Right? The one who is preparing for us rooms in the Father's house can't get one room in Bethlehem. Now, surely the God who sovereignly directed the wise men via the stars in the sky, he could have orchestrated so that there would have been an open room for the arrival of the Prince of Peace, his very own son. Could not the God who instructed Joseph in a dream to flee from Herod to Egypt, couldn't he have told Joseph, hey, make sure you arrive there early so you can get that room? Right, this is the God who spoke all of creation into existence with the word of his mouth. He speaks to creation. He commands the winds and the waves to be still, and it obeys. And is he not able to reserve one room in the inn? Right? Certainly he could have. But Christ, he was born in great humility in order to foreshadow what kind of life he was to live. Right? That is a life of spiritual and circumstantial poverty. The poverty of Christ was not a matter of material or economic poverty, but of circumstantial and spiritual poverty. And Christ's poverty is not constrained to his birth. We also see it in his life and his ministry. We'll just look at one verse to highlight this. Right? We can see clear evidence of Christ's poverty during his ministry when Jesus said that the foxes have holes and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. I think we ought to remember that on Christmas morning. Remember this on Christmas morning, that when you get up out of the comfort of your own beds to exchange gifts, remember that the Son of Man had nowhere to lay his head. Because you need to consider the great exchange. He became poor so that you might become rich. What would any of us have done? What would I do to have been able to give a pillow to our Lord? That the Son of Man had nowhere to lay his head is to show the lowliness of our Lord. So we see his poverty in his birth, and we see his poverty in his life and his ministry. We also see his poverty in his death and the events leading up to it. We see his poverty in his death and the events leading up to it. We won't take time this morning to consider the physical torture of his death. Instead, I'll just consider two other things. The first is that he was betrayed and abandoned by his closest friends. That's the kind of poverty. He's betrayed and abandoned by his closest friends. Matthew 26, verses 74 and 75 say this. Then he, that's Peter, then Peter began to curse and swear, I do not know the man. And immediately a rooster crowed. And Peter remembered the word which Jesus had said, before a rooster crows, you will deny me three times. And he went out and cried bitterly. Peter, a part of Christ's inner circle, not just right, among all people, but among the 12, one of his closest, dearest friends, in the moment of his need, Peter cursed and swore that he did not know Christ. In our lowest moments, I think almost all of us would probably have at least one, a dear friend who would stand by us. But his closest companions deserted him. So he's betrayed and abandoned by his closest friends. I think as I consider the poverty of Christ, I can't think of any greater poverty than what Christ experienced upon the cross when he was forsaken by his heavenly Father. Matthew 27, verse 46 says, my God, why have you forsaken me? This is the lowest point in all of history. This is the greatest poverty experienced by Christ. And I don't think Christ was quoting from Psalm 22 just for the sake of it. Jesus Christ, he experienced in his humanity what he never could have experienced in his deity. It was due to the incarnation that he could have said this. As he cried out to his Father, the sky turned dark as though to say there will be no response from heaven. The Father's face has turned away. Remember, before the incarnation, all that Christ has ever known is perfect relationship with the Father. And there as Christ hung upon the cross, in his time of greatest need, there was no comforter for he who is called the Great Comforter. I'll pause now again to ask the question, why is it important for you to meditate on the poverty of Christ? Christmas is a time of joy, but so why meditate? Why reflect on the poverty of Christ? Why think on the doctrine of the incarnation? First of all, you should meditate on the poverty of Christ because of the phrase, for your sake. Look back into your Bible at that verse 9. It says that though being rich, yet for your sake, he became poor. It was for your sake that Jesus Christ suffered poverty, that you might become immeasurably rich. It was for your sake that Jesus Christ was born so that you might never die. It was for your sake that Jesus Christ himself experienced tears so that one day he might wipe away every tear from your eyes forever. You should meditate on the poverty of Christ because he has done all of this for you. And you should meditate on the poverty of Christ because it has made you rich. You should meditate on the poverty of Christ because it has made you rich. And that takes us into our third and final point. We've already been saying it, but we have to say it again. Let's look at our text. That though being rich, yet for your sake, he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich. Put simply, the purpose of the incarnation of Jesus Christ, the purpose of his human birth and his life, is to make you rich. As Paul puts it, to make you rich, to bless you with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. When Paul writes, so that you might become rich, it infers that you were poor. And how great was your poverty? Apart from Christ, all your righteous deeds were like a filthy garment. You were dead in trespasses and sins. You were like a valley of dry bones or Lazarus rotting in the tomb. You had no hope unless someone rolls away the heavy stone of your own heart and calls out to you by name and says, come forth. It is through his poverty that Jesus Christ has made you rich. Through his poverty refers to the incarnation. As a result of the birth and the life of Christ, you were made rich. So when we celebrate Christmas, we in large part celebrate our very own story, our story of rags to riches. But more fundamentally, we celebrate Christ's story of riches to rags. He who was rich became poor. That's the Christmas story. Now, as I'm studying, I pause again to denote the question, why say the poverty of Christ again? Look back in your text. I'm going to read this again, and without through his poverty. So just follow along closely. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though being rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you might become rich. Right? It sounds just fine. Read it. Makes perfect sense. I totally get what he's saying. So why say it again? Why say so that you, through his poverty, might become rich? Right? Paul is emphasizing this because it is his poverty, right? Through his poverty, through his birth, his life, his death, all of his suffering, that you've become rich. He wants to highlight that. If you were to know more deeply the riches that you have in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, then you must meditate on Christ's poverty, because the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ is that his poverty is what makes you rich. I'll say that again. If you are to know more deeply the riches you have in the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, then you must meditate on his poverty, because the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ is that his poverty is what makes you rich. That is to say, the incarnation makes you rich. God being low makes you rich. The humble birth of Christ makes you rich. The poverty of his life makes you rich. And the humiliation of his death makes you rich. The final crucial question for our meditation this morning is this: in what way are you made rich? Or what are your riches? Your riches are first and foremost salvation and eternal life in Christ. That is a great, great gift. It is redemption and justification, peace and reconciliation. It is having clean hands and a pure heart. It is loving and being loved by God. It's the essence of John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he sent. Right, that's the Christmas story. He so loved the world that he sent his son, his only begotten son, so that if you would believe, you might not perish but have everlasting life. Consider your poverty then. Consider how poor you are. And hear the words of Isaiah in chapter 55. Right, that you who have no money, you who are poor, who are destitute, who have no hope, come and buy and eat. That's the offer of the gospel. So may we hear that, and may we receive the gospel of salvation in Christ. So again, your riches are first and foremost salvation and eternal life in Jesus Christ. But if you're thinking rightly, and if you're thinking deeply about your riches, Jesus Christ's poverty is not just for your salvation, but every blessing in your life. Every blessing and every good thing and every bad thing that God works for good in your life is owing to the poverty of Christ, because apart from his poverty, all that would remain for you and for me is complete and immediate condemnation, because you and I are guilty sinners before a holy God. Apart from the poverty of Christ and all it accomplished, none of us deserve even a millisecond of pleasure in God's creation. Therefore, every breath we take is a grace of God that we would not otherwise have if not for the poverty of Christ. If we see well or hear well or walk well, we can taste good food or speak with eloquence, that's grace. If we come together to laugh and to embrace and feel loved, that is grace. If we get to experience Christmas cheer and exchange gifts, and dare I say, kiss underneath mistletoes, that is owing to grace. Oh, that we would know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and in knowing, then worship. In the moment of the incarnation, the great deliverer was delivered unto you. And because the incarnation had an end in mind, right, the birth of Christ, it was going somewhere. The great deliverer would be delivered in another sense. I just happen to be reading from John 18 to the end of his gospel this morning. And as I was reflecting on the great deliverer being delivered, John 18 and 19, those two chapters repeat the word delivered at least five times. And it just stuck out like a sore thumb to me. I'll read to you the last usage of that word delivered. John 19, verse 16 says this. This is Christ standing before Pilate right before he's about to be condemned. John 19, 16. So he, Pilate, then delivered him over to them to be crucified. So he, Pilate, delivered Christ over to the Jews to be crucified. Right? In the birth of Christ, the great deliverer was delivered unto the world for salvation. And toward the end of his life, the great deliverer was delivered unto his own crucifixion. This is the glory and the weight of the incarnation. None of us could come to God. And so God came to us. You could not come to God on your own, and so he came to you. And he came not as a judge, but as a savior. He came not to collect debts, but to cancel debts. But he did far more than just cancel debts. He made you immeasurably rich in Christ. Knowing the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, may your Christmas be filled with rejoicing over all that Christ has done for you in his incarnation. The great deliverer delivered unto you so that you might be delivered. Let us pray. O Heavenly Father, our great God, we thank you for your great display of love, and that while we were still sinners, you saw fit to send your only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our own sins, to break us free from the chains of slavery to sin. You have made us a whole new creation through your Son, Jesus Christ, who is made low, who became man so that we might become more like him. And God, we have tasted just a little bit of that. And we long for the day when you will do away with the sinful desires of our flesh and make us complete in Christ in his second coming. And so we would pray, come. And as we wait, may our hearts be filled with worship. We ask and pray this in the name of your Son. Amen.